Since the end of the 1940s, the relationship between jazz and pop has been a difficult one. Before the advent of bebop, a lot of the music we nowadays consider to be jazz functioned essentially as an aspect of pop. Swing was king before bop changed the game. The complexity of the music played at Minton's by Charlie Christian, Thelonious Monk, Kenny Clarke and the others served to drive away the dilettantes and leave only the strongest players standing. It also culled the jazz audience, which it reshaped in its own image. And with the arrival of first rhythm and blues and then rock and roll, jazz and pop grew further and further apart. John Leslie Montgomery, the nickname Wes was a childhood diminutive of Leslie, was the exception who proved this particular rule. For the first half of a recording career which spanned most of a decade, Montgomery was the quintessential jazz guitarist, a neoclassicist raised in the Christian tradition and the post-bop mainstream, whilst massively extending both. Wes Montgomery was an innovator with a uniquely distinctive and much-copied approach to the instrument, which ensured that he was unlikely to remain in anyone else's shadow. His beguiling method of stating and then embellishing a melody through his trademarked thumb-stroked octaves enabled him to stand out, seemingly effortlessly, from the jazz guitar pack. But despite his later work's reliance on this device, he was also a dazzlingly fleet and fluent single-string improviser. According to that infallible indicator of the jazz audience's temperature, the downbeat poll, he was America's favourite jazz guitarist. Then came a change of record company and a change of approach. From 1964 onwards, Wes recorded a series of hugely successful albums concentrating on reinterpreting pop hits with orchestral or big band backing. These were massively popular, racking up immense sales and scoring him a Grammy Award, but the jazz hardcore felt betrayed by his seeming defection from the ranks of the true believers. In the hands of numerous imitators, Montgomery's octaves became a jazz-light lounge bar cliché. The more popular he became with the civilian population, the more his reputation suffered amongst jazz devotees. At the time of his death in 1968, he was effectively pegged as a major league jazz man corrupted and seduced away from the true path by the siren call of pop's filthy lucre. It wasn't until the advent of the acid jazz movement of the 1990s that some, by no means all, of Montgomery's later music was critically rehabilitated as pioneering proto-jazz funk, rare groove to the max. Wes Montgomery was born in Indianapolis, Indiana, in 1923, into a hard-working blue-collar family. His family were all musically inclined. Two of his brothers, bassist Monk and pianist vibraphonist Buddy, also went on to be successful professional musicians. As a teenager, Wes fell in love with Charlie Christian's guitar playing, and, soon after he got married at the age of 20, he bought himself an electric guitar and amplifier and set to work learning all of Christian's solos. The origins of his unique approach to the guitar derived from those earliest learning sessions. Without a teacher to steer him in more conventional directions, he discovered that, whilst practicing, he received fewer complaints from the neighbours when he played with his thumb, creating a smoother, mellower sound than he could using the more orthodox method of playing with a pick. What he lost in articulation, he gained in tone, though it must be said that he didn't lose that much speed. One awed spectator at an early Montgomery recording session claimed that the fastest thing he'd ever seen in his life was Wes Montgomery's right thumb. ¶¶
Hoy, hoy, it's the house of joy. You better come on in and dig, my boy. I say a ham's a wig, you ought to dig. Just in case you didn't know, here's Lionel Hampton's gumbo.
And that's for sure. One, two.
I want Washington apples, Philadelphia scrapple, wild about the sauce and baked beans. That's a dish no, you cats ain't never seen. Says I'm a whole potato.
Wes learned his stuff in local bands, one of which actually ventured as far afield as New York. His first real pro gig was with the indefatigable and seemingly indestructible Lionel Hampton, whose band he joined in 1948, playing alongside, among others, a young Charles Mingus. Hampton had, of course, worked alongside Christian himself in Benny Goodman's sextet 10 or so years before. Later on, Montgomery's brother Monk was to take the Hampton band's bass chair, becoming the first legit jazz player to use the then-new and radical Fender Precision solid-body electric bass guitar. Hampton was playing what was basically big band R&B, and Wes played mostly rhythm. Touring life didn't suit him, though. He had a growing family, six kids by 1959. Money was scarce, and he absolutely hated to fly. By 1950, he was back in Indianapolis. He spent most of the next decade working grueling day jobs. He was a welder for a while, and playing locally, sometimes with his brothers and sometimes with others. He cut a couple of sessions with his brother's band in Los Angeles, and his reputation began to grow. In 1959, alto saxophonist Cannonball Adderley and his cornetist brother Nat blew through town with George Shearing's band. They heard Wes play an after-hours organ trio gig in a local ghetto bar, and Cannonball marked Wes's card with Orrin Keep News of Riverside Records. Keep News flew to Indianapolis, listened to Montgomery's trio all night, and signed him on the spot at 6 a.m. Thank you.